when you've got the bite, you need to get the fish in, so take your time. But now's the time to be quick and to be back out there fishing. For this month's e-magazine, I'm back at one of my old haunts, Badshot Lea Big Pond. It's got fond memories for me, it's where a lot of my match fishing started, big matches, winter leagues, and as you can probably see, it is a big, big lake, quite a number of pegs on it. Today we're covering something a little bit different, fishing for bream on big, open, natural venues. Yes, there are a lot of carp in here, as well as a big head of catfish, grass carp. And you do get a lot of carp anglers, so we have got a slight commercial twist as far as the baits are concerned. It is a big natural lake with a massive head of bream. They're not always easy to catch, and unfortunately last night was the coldest night of the year so far. It went down to about 5.5 degrees, and it's only a shallow lake, average depth 4 to 5 foot, so the fishing could be a little bit difficult. But again, when you're fishing these big lakes for bream, it's not always about catching 100 pound or 80 pound. Sometimes it's about just catching a handful of fish. Fishing at distance, about 55 turns, there's a little bit of a gravel area there, and I know that these pegs are quite popular with the carp anglers. So what I'm hoping is that obviously the bream associate this area with a lot of bait going in by the carp anglers and obviously come to graze and eat the bait that they put in. I know, for instance, 2 weeks ago there was a match here, 80 pound won the match. There was a 60 pound on the point opposite us, even though it is opposite us, it is a long, long way away. This peg actually produced 60 pound, but the next peg only 4. And that's what this venue's like, and a lot of other venues with a big and got a big head of bream. The pegs aren't that close, and you can have a peg full of fish and a peg with not many in. But it's about just setting the trap, not going mad with the bait, and really trying to get a handful of bites. But there's always a chance that if these bream roll up in numbers, you can end up with a real big weight, because the average size of the fish in this lake is 3.5 to 5 to 6 pound. And there are fish in excess of double figures. That's without the carp, the grass carp, and obviously the catfish. They do hook an odd one in the matches here. They are few and far between, and to do well, it really is the bream that you're after. I'm now going to show you the two rods that I've set up for today's session. We're fishing quite a way out, 55 turns. You can obviously fish further, but I know it's an area that is targeted by the carp anglers, and hopefully we should catch a few bream fishing in that area. I might go a little bit further late on, or right late in the session, just in case, or if it is very, very difficult. I've got two rods set up. They're both the 11 foot tournament rods. Again, not the longest rods, but I know I can fish up to 70 to 80 turns with these rods. They're nice to play fish on. Not the longest rods again, but for bite registration and playing fish, they're absolutely perfect. Both got the TDX reels, the 3000s. On the open-ended feeder, I'll show you the setup in a minute, I've got 8 pound Darber ST line. Again, coming down slightly just to let me achieve the distance properly. You can see I've got a foot hook length, that's got a hair rig. I'm going to be starting on sweet corn today. Might go on to maggots if it's very difficult. And obviously I've got my boilies and the pellets for the method feeder. As you can see, a Drennan cage feeder, the medium size, a little bit of extra lead just glued on, just again to help me achieve the distance nice and easy. And a little bit of a twist, as you all know, through the carp fishing that we did last winter, I'm a massive, massive fan of fluorocarbon line. Not only for the strength and the reliability, but obviously the weight of it, it goes to the bottom and sinks. And these bream, they do get fished for quite a bit. Anything that stands out, they're definitely going to shy away from. I've just got a running paternoster, as you can see there. 6 foot of 8 pound fluorocarbon, just tied on loop to loop. Very similar to how we did in the winter. A small bead, and then a 3 inch paternoster with a swivel tied on. Nice simple rig, but very, very effective. More importantly, it is camouflaged. When the weight of the fluorocarbon just sinks to the bottom, it's virtually invisible. And hopefully these wary bream that do get fished for a bit, and also caught by the carp anglers, so they're not that easy to catch. Hopefully this will help us trick a few today in these difficult conditions. The second rod that I've got set up just a conventional method feeder. Again, a 30 gram method feeder. 020 hook length with a, this one's got a band on it, but as you probably know, I've got an assortment of hook lengths that I can change from boilies to maggots and back again. 30 gram feeder, just running as normal, just the normal commercial setup that I'd use for carp. Again, 6 foot of fluorocarbon to get that rig nailed to the bottom. When you get these fish moving around in your peg, any kind of camouflage will definitely help you get some bites. The only difference really on the two rods, the method feeder has got 10 pound main line. Again, because there are some very big carp in here, catfish and grass carp, and they can put in an appearance when you're fishing for the bream like this. The hook length on the normal feeder is 016. Again, quite strong. You don't need to fish too light. Again, they're big fish, but they do get wary and they have been fished for, so I'm not going to fish ultra heavy on the normal ground bait feeder. Just a little note, I've paced the rods out 55 turns, they're both bang on. If towards the end of the day, towards the end of the session, the fish have been very hard to come by, which they could be in the shallow water and cold conditions, I may well unclip the method and just search, leave it out there 10 minutes at a time, 5 or 10 metres past where we've actually been fishing. So I think now it's time to have a good look at the bait for today's session. I'm now going to have a look at the bait that I've bought for today's session. Now, when you're fishing for bream, obviously on a lot of commercial venues, the fish meal does come into it. This is a big natural venue, but it has got the twist of a lot of carp anglers fishing here. Hence, the bream do like fish meal, pellets, boilies, sweet corn, baits like this. If I was going to a big natural venue, obviously I'd back away if I knew that there's not so many carp anglers, so much high protein or fish meal going in by the carp anglers. But here at Badshot Lea, definitely fish meal does play a part, even for the bream. I mean, they really are hooked on it. As you know now, lakes like Gold Valley, Old Berry Hill, places like that, it really is pellets and fish meal ground baits. And this is no exception. Just here this morning, I've seen bait boats going out, spods going out by the carp anglers. One worrying thing is that they're not getting pestered by bream, which when the bream are having a go, it does happen. The carp anglers tend to get pestered a little bit by them. But for today's session, I'm going to keep it nice and simple. Mixes that I know work, pellets that I know work, and hook baits that I know that work. What I've got today, I've mixed up two different ground baits that I then put together. I've got the Old Ghost Bream, which is one of my favourites. It's a nice sticky bread type ground bait with a lot of soybean, and the bream really do love it. And what I do then, I've got some green alga, which as you probably know for bream is my number one. That really is my favourite. Not only do I catch a lot of fish on it, but I've got massive confidence, which when you're fishing these big lakes and you're waiting for the fish to roll up, or maybe only catching one or two fish on a hard day, you need to have confidence in your bait and know that you're not sitting there not catching because your bait's wrong. And basically what I do for the open ender and the method, you can see there I've got a mixture of the two ground baits along with some micro pellets, and that's just mixed together 50-50 the ground bait with a good handful of micro pellets that have been soaked, very similar to when we're fishing for carp. That's a nice sticky mix that not only goes nicely in an open end feeder, but also goes nicely around the method feeder. And what I don't want to do is have two different ground baits for when I'm fishing an open ender or a method. They're both clipped up, fishing in exactly the same place, and I want to be putting the same bait. I don't want to have different ground baits going on different feeders. This is a mix that not only lends itself to both feeders, but also a mix that I've got utmost confidence in. If we're not catching, I know it's definitely not the ground bait. As far as hook baits and that are concerned, obviously I've bought quite an array. I've got some dead maggots, which again is my favourite. If I'm not getting pestered, here at Badshot Lea, there are a lot of roach, a lot of perch, a lot of smaller fish. You can see them topping all around the margins. Really is alive with small fish, so maggots might not be an option. If the fishing is very difficult, then obviously I'll be trying two or three or four maggots on a slightly smaller hook. I've got the micro pellets there that I've soaked that can just be added through the session to the ground bait as I go. Then I've got my sweet corn, which again, on the open ender and the method feeder, will be my opening gambit, definitely. I know that a lot of sweet corn gets introduced here, especially for the grass carp, and I know that the bream definitely like to mop that up as well. So to start with, I'll be starting on the normal feeder with the mix of micro pellets and the two ground baits, and then a few bits of corn in there just to build up a an area that hopefully these bream will come in on. If the method feeder does play a part, I've got my boilies, red and white. White is definitely my favourite for bream, especially these big bream. They're in here in excess of double figures, and there's a good chance, if we do catch a few, of catching 1 6 or 8 pound. Also, the locals that fish here, some of my friends, Richard Kane, a good friend of mine who's fishing on the next peg to us today, has advised me that 8mm pellets, hard pellets, is definitely the number one bait for these bream. Whether that's because that's what everyone fishes in the match, I'm not so sure, but it will definitely be given a go later on the method feeder. As far as how much bait to introduce at the start, now obviously this has changed over the years. Before, when we were using brown crumb, not so high protein ground baits like fish meal, obviously you were putting in a bigger volume of bait. With today's more powerful baits, you don't need to put in a massive amount. I know I'm fishing in an area where the bream can be and the carp can be, so I'm just going to feel my way into the session. I'm going to leave my feeder out there 10 minutes at a time, reel it in, cast again, try and create an area, but slowly. Because the one thing I don't want to do is to cast out 10 or 15 times, put a big amount of bait in, when the bream could already have been there. You don't need a massive amount of this ground bait and these baits to hold these bream if they do come in, because of the power of the bait. So bream fishing for me has changed a little bit over the years. 10, 12, 15 years ago when I used to fish here, the first thing you do is either fire out 10 big balls of ground bait, have 10 or 15 chucks on a feeder, put a bed in. But the ground baits were a lot less powerful. They weren't full of high protein additives like fish meal, pellets, things like that, that are very powerful and can hold the fish with a smaller amount. So that's my setup. You've seen the setups of the two rods. You've seen the bait. You've heard my thinking behind it, the fact that I'm not going to introduce tons and tons of bait. As the day's getting on now, I think it's time to cast out and really start the session and try and catch a few of these big bream that are in here. And if we're lucky, maybe catch something else, like a carp or a grass carp. There really is a big head of fish in here. But with a cold night last night and a shallow lake, you know, the main ploy at the moment is to just catch one. Once we've caught one, then we can sit and wait, and hopefully, as the day goes on, a few more fish will move in. Well, there we go, there's a surprise. The first bite of the day has resulted in a real decent carp, which I'm not complaining at. It's not exactly what we came to do, but it does go to show what I said at the start about the setup and the way we're fishing. You can catch fish like this. Obviously, if you're fishing matches and it's not a silverfish match, it's an absolutely stunning Badshot Lea carp. And there you go, a bit of weed on him, but a fantastic fish. On the method feeder, it had a few chucks on a normal feeder with no bites. A method feeder, it literally been out there 3 minutes, and just by the bite I could tell that it wasn't going to be a bream. It was virtually pulling the rod in. So that's a fantastic sign. Like I say, not exactly what we came for, but again, a good result. Well, apart from that one carp, we haven't had any other indications. One tiny, tiny little liner and only that one decent bite. But on these days when you're fishing these big bream lakes, it's been cold and clear last night. It's only a shallow lake. You can see the sun's pretty much at its full height now. Fishing is going to be difficult. But the one thing is, always take heart on these big lakes, that the fish can just move in. There's a big head of bream in here, and carp, and at any time in a big expanse of water like this, they can just turn up and you can start getting bites. I may well unclip and go further towards the end of the session, just to look for one or two extra bites. But at this time, you know, we've not been fishing too long, I've had that one bite and I'm really just going to persevere in the same place and try and build it up and make it happen, and also being mindful of the fact that at any time they can just turn up. When you talk about how far to cast in these big lakes, obviously the temptation to cast a long, long way is quite big, but it's not always the case. You see the carp anglers, they look for gravel patches, gravel bars, and that's normally the best place to fish for the bream as well, purely because that's where the bait goes in, the quantity of bait, that's where the bait boats go, the spods, and that's where the bream are going to associate food with. So I'm not fishing too far, obviously you could cast a lot further, but I'm fishing into an area where I do know the carp anglers fish and the carp anglers feed and catch fish. So I'm quite confident that there are fish in the area, even though we've only had the one bite at the moment. Don't get always drawn into the distance trap. Yes, sometimes it can work, but 9 times out of 10, it's about fishing a comfortable distance in an area that you know is either targeted by other match anglers or by specimen anglers. As I showed you earlier, I've got 2 rods made up. And what I've done today is I've had the first 40 minutes, half hour, on my normal feeder to get a little bit of bait in. I don't want to go mad and put 10 feederfuls in, but I do want to put a little bit in. But what I want to be able to do is to cast out, leave it there for 5-10 minutes, and then reel in. This ensures the accuracy, the feed is emptied. A lot of the time, I think when you cast out, count to 10, and try and strike the bait out the feeder, you get a much bigger spread on your bait than you actually think. So a good tip on these big bream venues is to actually start on a normal feeder and then change to a method feeder in the same place. Yes, it's a little bit of aggro getting them clipped up at the same distance, but it's achievable and it doesn't take too long at all. And what I've done today, first 40-50 minutes on an open ender, get a little area of bait, and then I'm going to target trying to catch the fish on a method feeder. The one bite we have had at the moment has been on a method, first cast on the method, so it just goes to show that they are tuned into little piles of bait. But again, I've got that little spread of probably 10 or 12 casts in the first 40 to 50 minutes on a normal feeder, just to give the bream a little bit of an area to graze over. And if I do catch one and they move away, they're still going to be over a little bit of bait. There's a little bit of wind, a little bit of tow. I can tell by the bend in my tip that there's a little bit of tow, and that'll just give the little bit of spread on the bait that I've put in with the open ender. Very rarely will I go back to an open ender, but some days it can be quite good, especially if it's warm and the fish are up in the water. You've got a slightly longer hook length than obviously on a method feeder. And if the fish are coming immediately when the feeder hits the bottom, a normal feeder can be a better bet. But 9 times out of 10, after an hour, that's when I like to make the change to a method feeder. Once I've established an area, got a little bit of bait in, then I'm going to look at targeting and actually catching the fish on a method feeder. Well, there we go. I think we've got our first bream on, which is good timing. We've had that one carp. You don't really want to go in and catch bream immediately. You want a bit of bait going in, like I say. I think this is one of the bream, the famous Badshot Lea Big Lake bream. It certainly feels like it. It was quite a decent pull, though, to be fair. And I definitely had a little liner just before, which again is a fantastic sign. 120 hook length, like I say, that's the beauty when you're fishing the method feeder. You can still fish, even for the bream, you can fish heavy line, big hooks. There's a little bank of weed there, and I don't like to lift my rod up, but I'm going to have to just lift it up. There you go, just steered it over the weed. It's about 20-25 metres out, there's just a little bank of weed, and it's quite lucky because Richard, my friend, is fishing just up from us, and he actually told me that's a nice, a real decent slab, and that's fantastic. Nice timing. We got some bait in. Absolutely fantastic. There's a bit of weed as we've come through the bank of weed. But you can see why I like this lake so much. The size of the carp we've caught is fantastic. But that is a fantastic bream. Going to kick probably a good 4.5-5 pound and an 8mm pellet on a method feeder, mainly micros with a little bit of ground bait just to hold it together. But Fantastic. I'm going to get him in the net quite quickly because I want to get back out there with a feeder full of bait, just in case a few have rolled up. So there we go. I'm going to get the feeder loaded up. Always like to put a fresh pellet on. Hook bait choice on the method is quite a personal thing. Some people like boilies, corn, but 8mm pellets, I was told by one of my friends, is definitely catching the bream and the other fish here. And I'm quite open-minded as far as hook baits. I haven't really got a favourite or a personal preference. So nice 8mm pellet. Just going to put the pellet in the mould and then fill it full of the ground bait and pellet mixture. A nice firm press and another firm squeeze just to make sure that it's going to stay on all the way out there. And again, just look at the marker and a nice solid punch. Heard it hit the clip there. Feel it to the bottom. And first things first, I put a nice healthy bend in the tip because I want to get that line sunk. I want to get that fluorocarbon down on the bottom. Get the line sunk, then I relax the tip a little bit. Let that fluorocarbon sink just to create that trap, an invisible trap. You've seen the size of the bream now, and you've seen the size of the carp in this lake. They really do take a little bit of catching. About a minute or so, that line will all be sunk, and I'll relax the tip, letting that fluorocarbon just sink to the bottom. You've got a little pile of bait then in the feeder. You hook bait very close to it, obviously, because we're fishing a method. And then that fluorocarbon absolutely nailed to the bottom. And that's going to create a virtually invisible trap. Well, there we go, there's our second one in as many casts, and I think it's fair to say that maybe, if I don't want to count my chickens, but I think it's fair to say that a few have arrived. And when you see the average size of these fish, you can see why, you know, a weight of 60 to 80 pound can be achievable in not a lot of time. But the most important thing is having patience when the fish aren't there, but when the fish are there, is to try and, you know, obviously when you've got the bite, you need to get the fish in, so take your time. But now's the time to be quick and to be back out there fishing. What you don't want is to have a peg full of hungry bream all of a sudden and not bait going in on a regular basis. You can't afford to really take your time. You can afford to take your time once the feeder's out there waiting for the bite. But as far as when you've put one in the net to getting your feeder back out there into the zone, you definitely want to try and be as quick as you can. Again, a nice firm squeeze. Eye straight on the marker. Absolutely bang on that one. Again, a nice healthy bend in the tip. You still get a bite, you know, it's not that if you do get a bite early that you're not going to see it, it will just be a bit more ferocious because you've got a nice healthy bend in the tip. But it's important for me with the rigs that I like to use that obviously have fluorocarbon in them, it's very important to get that rig set and sunk as quick as possible. And sinking the line at the distance we're fishing at today, it means putting a nice healthy bend in the tip, waiting for that line to be sunk, takes less than a minute. Then just relax the tip, letting that fluorocarbon sink and become invisible. And I think that's one of the reasons on a very hard day when other people seem to be struggling, that we're getting an odd pull now. Well, there we go. The feeder's all back in the spot where we started to catch a few. I've relaxed the tip, let that fluorocarbon sink. Hopefully, we'll be into another fish quite soon. While I'm waiting for the next bite, just gives me a chance just to touch on one thing. As you know, in the past, I keep saying to you that things change, things develop, and what I might tell you one week could change to the next because I've found a better way of doing it. Not that we're using them very much today, but as far as dead maggots are concerned, as you know, I've always been quite a fan of killing them with hot water. So by freezing them, what you get is the actual maggot shape left. They're not that long stretched maggot which you do get when you kill them with hot water. And I think that that's much, much better. If you get an actual dead maggot that is still the exact shape as alive, for me it's got to be a lot better. So I like to keep you updated in any little twists and turns and changes that I have in my fishing. That ain't a bream. That is a big fish, that is. That is a proper carp, that one. Trouble is, it's all weed. From pulling the fish, all the weed, you know? Well, there we go, there's another bream now. Really is thick and fast action now. Virtually won every cast. We have had a real nice fish as well, nice common carp, probably around about the 20 pound mark. It just goes to show that on venues like Badshot Lea Big Pond, when you fish heavy on the method feeder, it's not just the bream, but these bonus carp and fish like that. You've got a real good chance on 020, 018 of getting these fish in. We've had two carp today for probably about 32, 34 pound. And like I say, not only when you're pleasure fishing are they fantastic fish to catch, but in matches they really are big bonuses. It was looking a little bit dodgy for a while. We'd only had that one carp, and then all of a sudden, textbook bream fishing, you get one, next chuck you've got another one, and on and on and on. And like I say, we really have had quite a net full of bream now, and with the two carp mixed in. But again, it's a case of accurate casting, patience, being quick when you need to be, i.e. from putting one in the net to being back out there again. And everything really has worked well. We had that 45, 50 minutes on a normal feeder to get a little bit of bait out, a little bed of feed, and then change to a method feeder with a hair-rigged 8mm pellet, which one of my friends who fishes here quite a lot assured me was the best bait. But again, that just goes to show that homework done before the session or before the match can be vital. Just listening to things, not thinking that by any means that you know everything and that you're going to just go and fish your own match, but listening to good anglers that fish these venues, and some of the information you can pick up can really stand you in good stead. As you can see today, I've fished obviously normal line in conjunction with fluorocarbon. A lot of people ask me about braid. It's not my favourite, especially for fish this big. There are circumstances when I'm feeder fishing that braid would be a must. If I was fishing closer for smaller fish, then it would definitely come into play. When you're fishing these big lakes with big fish, they're going to give you proper bites. In my opinion, there's no need. Also, the braid, if you use it for hook lengths, it's not quite as stiff as a thick mono, and fish can eject it, in my opinion, much, much easier. A nice thick 020 line, just like the Super G line or the Match Winner, it's very hard for the fish to eject because of the stiffness of the line. As you can see today, we've only missed one bite. Everything else has been put virtually in the net. So again, I'm not a lover of braid because of how direct it is for big fish, but for smaller fish, then it is definitely a must for me. Also, in conjunction with a method feeder, you can obviously fish a lot heavier, slightly bigger hooks, definitely heavier line as far as the hook length's concerned. And as you've seen today, if this were to be a match, the two carp that we've managed to land are going to be one heck of a bonus. On lighter line, 014, 016, the bigger one for sure, because it weeded us twice, and you just would not have seen that fish. But on 020 line and a decent size hook, we were able to not only just land the fish, but get the rigging intact and everything and be straight back out in amongst the feeding fish. You don't need to fish that light when fishing a method feeder. Obviously, when you're fishing a normal feeder, because the hook length's exposed and away from the feeder, you tend to find yourself wanting and needing to fish slightly lighter. Fantastic combination if you get your two rods clipped up right is a normal feeder and a method feeder. Start on the normal feeder, create a bit of an area, change to a method feeder. If it is warm and the fish are taking on the drop, then obviously a normal feeder can still be a good gambit. But if you've got both the rods clipped up in the same place, it's very easy to swap and change. Well, there we are, we've reached the end of the session. The day's really got on, but what a fantastic day. When the fish arrived, it really was non-stop action, and the icing on the cake was definitely that big common. Again, by fishing heavy, we managed to land two carp, one of which was probably close to 20 pound, if not just over. Really did put the icing on the cake for the day, and the bream rolling up is just fantastic. It was a real cold night last night, followed by a cold morning, and a bright, bright day, which isn't normally the best conditions to catch bream. But here at Badshot Lea, there really is a fantastic head of fish, not just bream, but like you've seen today, carp. And it never really does let you down. Just one thing, you might be wondering, why did I start on a cage feeder? Obviously, the actual reason to start on an open end feeder I've explained, to create that area. But why a cage feeder? As you can see, I've got a bag of open-ended feeders, some cage, some plastic. I prefer the cage because they tend to empty quicker, they empty a little bit on impact, give you that little bit of an area, and that's why I like them for bream, especially in shallow water. They can work well in deep water, but when you're faced with these big lakes with an expanse of water, you want a little bit of a spread just to create that area, and a cage feeder helps you do that. It fished in conjunction with a method feeder, you can see the results for yourself. It's been fantastic. Well, there we go. There's a small selection of the bream that we caught today. The carp were put back immediately. Most of the bream have gone back, and there's a few that we just kept for a catch picture. There's fish close to 8 pound. Fantastic day. And the combination of the open-ended feeder and the method feeder fished over the top has definitely worked. When you fish these big open expanses of water for bream, be patient. Put some bait in at the start. Be prepared to fish for these bream the same way you would do for carp.